Justice shines like slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace.
Worship His Majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom authority flows from His throne unto His own. His anthem reigns. Majesty,
majesty,
worship His majesty.
Majesty,
unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, from His throne unto His own, His anthem reigns. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, glorify Christ Jesus the King. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings. Majesty,
majesty,
worship His majesty.
Majesty,
unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. From His throne unto His own, His anthem reigns. So exalt,
lift
up on high the name of Jesus. Let's magnify, glorify Christ Jesus the King.
Majesty,
worship His majesty.
Majesty,
this Jesus.
Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Lord Jesus, we do magnify your name and we praise you and we honor you. We honor you, we honor your Father, our Lord God. And again, we give ourselves to you, we give this time to you, and we ask a special blessing on Dr. Jack as he comes to speak, that you would speak through him and that we would learn and that we would honor you, and that we would be transformed because of your work here today. Amen. Now, as in your bulletin, you may notice that there is an envelope that will go especially to Messiah in the Passover. So if you would like to give to help thank Jack and Alice, who came today to present to us, you may do that. There may be another envelope for the church, but that makes it very clear what people's intention is. There's also, so as you leave, there is an offering box that you walk right by. It is the one with the masks sitting on it. Also, Dr. Jack has out here several resources, printed resources, that I encourage you to take a look at. He has come well prepared today. Dr. Jack, come and bless us. Would you give him a hand?
This mic keeps moving on me, but can y'all hear me? Okay, y'all know shalom? Shalom. I'd like for you all to say shalom to me. And I would say shalom alechem. That means peace, y'all. How many of you think Jack Meadows sounds Jewish? How about Yankel Medvedovsky? Can you hear me? I can hear me. Okay, my family came from Russia through Israel and then settled here in Portland. I was raised in Southwest Portland. I was born and raised. Alice and I were married here, and now we're back home again. This keeps moving, but eventually we'll get it settled. I got too many things on my ear, I think. You should have gotten one of these in your bulletin. It talks about the ministry. I just want to give you a brief history of the ministry. It started in Brooklyn in 1894. A rabbi from Poland, Dr. Joseph Cohen, Leopold Cohen, came. He came from Poland. He received Jesus as his savior in Brooklyn. Once he received him, then he wanted to start telling all of his Jewish family and friends about Jesus. And he opened up a storefront and started, and that was the beginning. It went from that to the American Border Missions to the Jews. And then the name was changed to Chosen People Ministry just a few years ago. Our purpose is stated in the brochure in Romans 1:16, that we are not ashamed of the gospel of God. It is the power of salvation to all those who believe, both the Jew and the Gentile. Our basic ministry here in Portland, when we can, which we haven't been able to do now for years, evangelism, to go out on the streets and talk to people and want to share Jesus with them. When people come to know the Lord, when they receive Jesus, or they want to get more information, we will have Bible studies with them and try to help them to grow and eventually get them moved into a good Bible teaching church. So that's basically the way that the ministry works. And if you have, we have branches now in over 17 countries. I don't know how many there are within the states, but the Lord has blessed the ministry and the Lord has kept us going and honored the sharing of the gospel. Now, if you have your brochure with you, if you would open it up or you can look at it later, but there is a page, a tear-out strip on the ministry on this end of the brochure that if you would like to receive our prayer letter and also be receiving the ministry monthly newsletter, you fill out your name and you can just check a box, send me your newsletter so I can pray for the work of chosen people. And you can hand this up to me at the table after the service is over, or you can drop it in the offering box also, and eventually that would get to me. Now, the ministry is not only reaching out in evangelism and teaching. We do have a couple of websites, three of them actually, but the third one is just opening up. It's called Chosen People Answers, and it's going to be a website which has much information about Messiah, brochures, answering questions, opportunities to ask questions, but also the current websites that we have. One is Isaiah53.com, where you can go on, find out about Isaiah 53. If an unbeliever comes on, wants to have more information, we can call back and talk with them. But if you'd like to look at it, we have these cards on the table on Isaiah53.com. Also, the second one is called I Found Shalom. And I Found Shalom is also on the table in the back. It is open, and what it is the testimony of many believers, Jewish believers, and how they came to know that Jesus is the Messiah. So the websites are there. You can go onto them and see what there is. Also, as the pastor has mentioned, I do have a table out in the back, which has books and brochures produced by the ministry and other ministries. If you look at the table, you see there's two sides. On the right side, we have a lot of the brochures. I have a little card that says says free. On the other side of the table, we have books and larger items, and we have a little card that says not so free. But I would like to be there at the table. If you have any questions, you can talk with me after the service is over. I'll be out there. One other thing I would like to say is the pastor talked about the offering, is that we do not want the offering to come out of your tithe to the church. Because your first responsibility is to your pastor, to the church where you are taught and where you fellowship. So if you want to make out a check to Chosen People Ministries and the Lord is leading you to do that, then we would welcome that. Also, if you are not a believer, then we're not asking you to give, because support of the ministry and support of the Lord's work is the joy of the Lord's people. So if you don't know the Lord, our words and our message to you today is simply, don't give, but receive. To receive the gift of eternal life through faith in Jesus Christ. So if you have any other questions, I'll be out in the foyer after the service is over and you could share with that. Now, as I mentioned, I was born and raised in Portland. And what we're going to share this morning as we go through is how our family celebrated the Passover dinner. Now, the Passover dinner is remembrance of what the Lord did for our people in Exodus chapter 12 and other chapters in that area, where we were in bondage in Egypt, in slavery. And the Lord worked through the 10 plagues, worked through his sacrifice of the lamb, where he brought us out of bondage and brought us to himself, and then directed us toward the promised land. So the Passover, he commanded us to remember this every year. And so the Passover table is a remembrance and looking back and telling and reminding of the history of our exodus, of our deliverance from bondage in Egypt into the becoming God's children. So let's pray before we begin. Father, we thank you again just for your love for us. We thank you for your sacrifice of your Son as the Lamb of God, that we could receive him and come into your family. We ask now that as we go over, review the Passover, that we would see you, that you would be lifted up. And I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, as I mentioned, I was born, raised here in Portland, and a great amount of our family lived in Portland. But we only had two of my uncles who had houses large enough for all of us to come together for a Passover dinner. So we would alternate between these houses. But during the Passover week, there is a tremendous house cleaning that is going on. The house is cleansed, and anything that has leaven in it is removed out of the house, because the rabbis say we're not to have any leaven or eat any leaven during the week, the 8 days of Passover and the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. The reason that we do not eat leaven is our rabbis remind us that in the scriptures, leaven so many times is a picture of sin, a symbol of sin. And during this time, as we remember God redeeming us, we want to separate ourselves as much as possible and live a life that is pleasing to God. So there is no leaven eaten during the Passover and the 7 day feast of unleavened bread. So the day of the Passover, all of the males would go to shul. We'd go to synagogue where we would have the afternoon and the evening services preparing for the Passover. And while we were gone, the women would be home, they would be cooking, they would be setting up the table, so that as when we came home from shul, that the table would be set up, we would be ready to go. One of the reasons we need to start right at time is because the service, if we do the whole dinner and the whole Haggadah, the Passover Haggadah is the telling of the story, and this is what we follow as we go through. And the whole service and the dinner takes close to 3 hours, so we want to get started and be ready when we come home. So as soon as we men come home from shul, we would all put on our yarmulkes, our head coverings, because an Orthodox Jewish male would not go into a worship service with his head uncovered. And the Seder service is a worship service. And then my uncle, who would be leading the service, would put on his prayer shawl, his tallis. Because at this time, he's not just the leader of the feast and teaching us and the family patriarch, but he's also our priest, because he's going to be leading us in the worship service of the Lord. Now, once we have all had our yarmulkes on and we are seated, my aunt would light the Passover candles. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Olam. Come on. Asher kidshonu b'mitzvasov lahadlik ner shel Pesach. Blessed art thou, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who sanctifies us with your commandments and has commanded us to light the Passover candles. Once the candles are lit, then we would open our Haggadah. And as I mentioned, the Haggadah is the telling of the story. And this is what leads us in our worship service. You'll notice on the table that we have here elements that would be on the Passover Seder plate before my uncle. And the elements I will use to explain what we are going through the service, and we would all be taking part and using. But this is a Seder plate. You will notice that there are four cups that we have on the table. This signifies that during the course of the dinner and the service, we will be taking and drinking from four different cups. Each cup has a specific name and a specific place in the service. And once the candles are lit and once we sit down, then the first cup we take and we pour. And the first cup is called the cup of blessing, because we are asking for the Lord's blessing as we enter into the service. And we have a prayer for blessing, and then we go Baruch Atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Olam Borei Pri Hagafen. Blessed art thou, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. And then we would drink the first cup. And then we would start the service. And the first thing that we do after we have our first cup is we take some parsley and some salt water. And we dip it twice in the salt water. And then Baruch Atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Olam Borei Pri Ha'odama. Blessed art thou, O Lord our God, King of the universe, creator of the fruits of the earth. And the reason that we do this, our rabbis tell us, and dipping twice is that in Exodus chapter 12, we are reminded that and told that this is to be the beginning of months for you. That at this point, God says, we're going to be starting something new. And so the greenery speaks of new birth and speaks of growth. And the salt water speaks of the tears that our ancestors shed when we were in bondage in Egypt, and the Red Sea, which God opened up for us as he brought us out. This is a matzah tash. It's a matzah cover, but it's a very special matzah cover because there's one compartment with a matzah unleavened bread in it. There's a second compartment with another matzah unleavened bread in it. And there is a third compartment with a matzah in it. And the rabbis say the reason that we have this on the table reminds us of the unity of our nation. That the first matzah, they say, represents the Kohen Gadol. He was the high priest when the temple was open and we were following and under the law at that point. So the Kohen Gadol, the second matzah represents the tribe of Levi of the Jewish people. And they were the people who served under the Kohen Gadol and helped in the service of the temple when it was standing. And the third matzah it says Am Haaretz, the rest of the people of Israel. And that even though there was the Kohen Gadol, the Levitical tribe, and the rest of the nation of Israel, yet we are one. And that is the unity of the people. Now, as I'm explaining what we went through the Passover dinner, I will be taking times as a Jewish believer, as a Jewish person who believes that Jesus is the Messiah, to explain what I really believe about this, what God is really trying to tell us through this Seder. And think with me, just as a believer, as a Christian, that God might be trying to tell us with this three-compartment matzatash. And what I believe is that the first compartment speaks of God the Father. The second speaks of God the Son. And the third speaks of God the Holy Spirit, that it is a picture of the Trinity. Now, in the Passover, after we explained, my uncle explains the tash, we pull out the middle matzah. And you ask our rabbis, why pull out the middle matzah, which represents the tribe of Levi? And normally the rabbis would look at us and they say, I don't know. They do not have an answer for that. But what is done is that the middle matzah is pulled out, which I believe represents the Son, and the middle matzah is broken. And half of it is laid back on the table to be kept for later, and half of it is wrapped in a napkin. This is called the afikomen. You might just remember afikomen. And once my uncle has wrapped the afikomen, he would leave the table and he would walk through the house. He'd go through his entire house, and all of us young people at the table would be listening intently. And when my uncle came back from a walk, that walking, he no longer had the afikomen with him, because he had hidden the afikomen somewhere in the house. Remember, the afikomen, the middle matzah, broken and has been taken now and hidden. And then the second cup, the cup would be filled for the second cup in the service. And this cup is called the cup of the plagues. And once that is filled, then the youngest son that was sitting at the table would rise and would ask the four questions. And I was the youngest son. And because God tells us in Exodus that when your son shall ask you, why do you do these things, you will tell him. And this goes on with the explanation. So I would stand, Manishtana halayla hazeh mikol halelot. Why is this night different from all other nights? Shebachol halelot anu ochlin chumetz u'matzah. On all other nights, we may eat in either leavened or unleavened bread. Halayla hazeh kulo matzah. But on this night, only unleavened bread. On all other nights, we may eat any kind of herbs, but on this night, only bitter herbs. On all other nights, we do not even dip once, but on this night, we dip twice. On all other nights, we may eat either sitting or reclining, but on this night, we all recline. Now, to take the last question first, on our chairs, there would be a pillow. And the pillow would be there so that as we ate, we would be reclining. And our rabbis explained this, is that when we were in bondage in slavery in Egypt, we stood and we served and we waited. But now that we are free people, that God has brought us out, we can rest and we can recline as we eat. So we have the pillows. So the questions having been asked, my uncle, who would be leading the feast, would then start leading us through the Haggadah, through the telling of the story. Because we were slaves under Pharaoh in Egypt, and the Eternal, our God, brought us forth thence with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. And he begins to read many pages. And if I read all the pages, we would be here for a long time. So I'm just going to move forward to where we have and come to the 10 plagues. And remember, the second cup is called the cup of the plagues. And what we would do in our family as we came to this point is we take a knife in one hand, we would have the cup of wine in our other hand, and then we would dip the knife in the cup and say the Hebrew name of the plague, Dom, and then we take it out and knock the drop off and say English, blood. Tsephardea, frogs. Kanim, vermin. And we would do this until they come to the last plague, Machot Bechorot, the death of the firstborn. And we have taken 10 drops out of the cup. And our rabbis explain it that the reason we do this is a full cup is a cup of joy and rejoicing. But we do not rejoice when you think, we do rejoice when we think of what was accomplished in bringing us out of bondage, but we do not rejoice when we think of the cost. And that is why we take the 10 drops out for the plague. Now, as believers in Jesus Christ, we can understand that. Rejoicing because of redemption, but not rejoicing because of what it cost. As we think about it, that Jesus died on the cross to pay the penalty for our sins. But we rejoice with the redemption that we have received. Rabbi Gamliel says that whoever does not make mention of three things at the Passover feast has not done his duty, namely the sacrifice of the Passover, the unleavened bread, and bitter herbs. And then we start following the instructions. The Paschal lamb, which our ancestors ate during the existence of the temple, for what reason was it eaten? And if we had Exodus 12 open, we would look at the qualifications for the lamb. That the lamb was to be a male, he was to be in the first year of life, the prime of life. He was to be taken out of the flock on the 10th of the month. He is kept and observed until the 14th of the month, 3.5 days. Then the lamb was taken and slain, and the blood is shed. And then we were told to take that blood that was shed and apply it to the lintel and the doorposts of the house. Isn't that an interesting? Have the blood in the bowl, you dip hyssop in it, put it on the lintel and on the doorposts of the house. And then you would sit behind that blood door. Now, God doesn't have to tell us why he is telling us to do something. But in this case, as you read through Exodus 12, we are reminded because God tells us why he wants that done. It says, "Now, for I will pass through the land of Egypt on that night and will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. Now the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. And what you have is that the blood of that perfect lamb was the difference between life and death. When the death angel went through the land of Egypt, if there was no blood on the door, there was the death of the firstborn. But if God saw the blood, he said, I will pass over you. As a Jewish believer, believing that Jesus is the Messiah, you can see where this is leading. The Lamb is a picture of Jesus. He is in the prime, a male, in the prime of life. He was 33 years old. He was observed for 3.5 years, 3.5 days, for 3.5 years. When they put him to trial, they found no sin in him. He was perfect. He was then put on the cross. He was sacrificed. His life was taken from him. And then we are told that the difference between life and death is that personal application of the blood. And when you and I have received Jesus Christ into our lives, from that point on, God, looking down from heaven, does not see Jack Meadows sinner, but he sees Jack Meadows covered with the blood of the perfect lamb. If you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, that's the message for you. Take the blood, apply it, believe in Jesus Christ, receive him into your life, and you'll pass from death into life. This is God's guarantee. So the lamb is the paschal lamb whose blood was the cause of our deliverance from bondage to Egypt, from Egypt. 1 Corinthians 5:7 reminds us Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. Now, also on the table is a brown egg, boiled. And this reminds us that whenever the nation of Israel came up to Jerusalem to sacrifice the Passover lamb at Passover, we could always make a special offering to God for thanksgiving for who he is and what he is doing. The unleavened bread which we eat, what does it represent? It reminds us that when the Lord brought us out of bondage in Egypt, our bread did not have time to leaven or rise, and we eat unleavened bread. This is horseradish sauce. And it says the bitter herb which we eat, and it is eaten because the Egyptians embittered our lives when we were in bondage in slavery. In every generation, each individual is bound to regard himself as if he had gone personally forth from Egypt. As it is said, you shall relate to your son on that day, saying, this is on account of what the Eternal did for me when I went forth from Egypt. Thus it was not our ancestors alone whom the Most Holy, Blessed He redeemed, but us also did He redeem with them. And so as a nation, we're speaking of the national redemption that God brought us out of bondage. And then we take the second cup and lift it and say, blessed are you, O Eternal, our God, King of the universe, who has redeemed us and our ancestors from Egypt and has brought us to the enjoyment of this night. And Baruch Atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Borei Pri HaGofen, and we would sip and take from the second cup. And then my uncle would take, remember the half of the matzah, and my uncle would take the matzah at this point, and he would break it and pass a piece to every one of us at the table that we would have a piece of the unleavened bread. At this point, I'm going to turn to Luke chapter 22. And talks about Jesus and the disciples at the table. And he took, then said unto you, I'll no longer eat of it until it's fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and said, divide it among yourselves, for I say unto you, I will drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And the early drinking of the cup in the dinner. And then he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. And I believe it's at this point in the Passover dinner that the Lord took the matzah, broke the bread, passed it out to his disciples, and said, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. And I believe that it's here that we have the institution of the bread at the communion table, where we remember our Lord's death till he come. And then we would take some other matzahs that were on the table. We'd break it, take a piece of matzah, and we'd take some of the horseradish. Now, my aunt would grind her own horseradish the day of the Passover. And I've never had horseradish as potent as my aunt's horseradish was made. But we would take a piece of matzah, and my uncle would want us to take a teaspoon of horseradish, which we tried not to do, but put it on the piece of matzah, and then we would eat it. And Baruch Atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Kidshonu B'Mitzvosov V'Tzivonu Al Achilat Morar. Blessed art thou, O Lord our God, who sanctified us with your commandments and commands us to eat bitter herbs, and we would eat it. And you know what happens when you eat horseradish, especially if it's my aunt's horseradish? It immediately would bring tears to our eyes, and we would be crying over the bondage of the slavery in Egypt. But then we would take another piece of matzah, and we would put a little bit of horseradish on it. And then we would take some charoseth, which is a mixture of apples and nuts and spices and wine, which is very sweet and very good. And we take a big spoon of the charoseth and put it over the horseradish. And then we would eat it. And our rabbis say, how sweet is redemption after the severity of bondage. Amen? How sweet is redemption after the bitterness of bondage. And then we would eat dinner, including the full dinner, including tea, coffee, after the service is over. And once we have finished dinner, my uncle would look at all of us young people at the table, and he'd say, go find it. And immediately we would leave the table, and we would start scouring the house, because, and what are we looking for? Remember the afikomen? And we would, whoever found the afikomen would bring it back to the table and give it to my uncle. And my uncle would give us a cash gift. So more than one way to keep kids awake during dinner. But then we had a cash gift. And then my uncle would take the afikomen and unwrap it. And he would break pieces and pass it around for every one of us to have a bite to eat. Now this piece of afikoman replaces the last bite of lamb, which would have been eaten, which would have been the strength for the journey. But I want us to think through this afikoman together. Think about the matzahs. I didn't mention it, but matzahs are made in a very special way. They are made with stripes. And remember, we're talking about the middle matzah, which was the son. By his stripes, we are healed. In the stripes, if you look at it, there are pierce marks, pierced for our iniquities, broken, wrapped, buried, then brought up and unwrapped again for everyone to see. You see the picture? Every year, my mishpucha, my family, relatives, as they celebrate the Passover dinner, are remembering the death and the burial and the resurrection of Yeshua. And they don't know it. And they need to know it. And then the third cup is filled. And it is called the cup of redemption. And during this time after dinner, there are many prayers and thanking God again for the history. And we read, "We will give thanks unto you, O eternal our God, for having caused our ancestors to inherit that desirable, good, and ample land, and because you have brought us forth from the land of Egypt and redeemed us from the house of bondage." And there is the thanking of God for past redemption, that he's brought us out of bondage to Egypt. And we move forward a few more pages. And then, "May he who is most merciful send us Elijah the prophet of blessed memory to bring us the good tidings of salvation and consolation. May he who is most merciful blessed." And on the table, there is a special cup. And many Orthodox Jewish families have a place setting, which is set because we look forward to Elijah coming, because we are told that Elijah will come, and we feel, on the Passover, and will introduce the Messiah to us. And so at this point, the youngest son, which was me, would get up and go to the door, open the door, and look out. And I would come back in shaking my head, "No, Elijah has not come." So my people do not know that Elijah has come and has introduced us to the Messiah, that Jesus is the Messiah. So they pray and look forward to the coming of Elijah. Reading on a few more pages, "May he who is most merciful make us worthy to behold the day of the Messiah and eternal life in the future state." So it is not only the prayer and the thanksgiving for the past redemption, there is the prayer looking forward to a future redemption when Messiah will come and eternal life for the future state. Then my uncle would, and we would move forward to the taking of the third cup. But before we take and I say the prayer for the third cup, I'm looking at Luke chapter 22 again. Where it says in verse 20, "Likewise he," Jesus, "also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is a new covenant of my blood, which is shed for you. And in 1 Corinthians 11, it says, as often as you drink this, do this in remembrance of me. So the third cup, the cup of redemption, which in the Passover is just thanking the Lord for past redemption, looking forward to future redemption, is the cup that our Lord took and shared that this is the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you. This do in remembrance of me. And I believe this is the cup and the setting for the communion cup that we remember his death till he come. And at the after we've had the prayers in the Haggadah, and we would sip and take from the third cup. And then it is filled the fourth time for the fourth cup. And after the fourth cup is called the cup of praise. And during the Haggadah, we would read from Psalms 115 to 119. There would be some songs that we would sing for the young people, and we would be thanking God for his remembering and for his redemption from bondage. And moving to the end of the night, we'd say, Lashono Habo'o Berushalayim, next year may it be in Jerusalem. And we end looking forward to the coming of the Messiah and say, next year may we be in Jerusalem with the Messiah. And then, Baruch Atarunoi Eloheinu Melech Olam Borei Pri HaGofen, and we take from the fourth cup. And that is the end of the service. So just want to thank you. You've been very attentive. And thank you so much. I'm glad that you are here today. And if you have any questions, I'll be out at the table. You can talk with me afterwards. Let's pray. Father, thank you now for your love for this time as we remember your giving of your son, Jesus, and the eternal life that you give us, the redemption in him. And we do pray for our Jewish friends, Father, that they would see the truth about you. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I personally love Exodus because I see so much symbolism in many, many things that the Jewish people, the Israelites, went through. And they symbolize our lives, and then Jesus as our Savior, who redeems us from sin, who takes us out of bondage, who gives us a new life, who gives us a hope and a future. And there is so much more than we can even explain to you. It is beautiful. But as Jesus died, and it was his blood that keeps death, spiritual death, passing over us, right? So that we do not die spiritually. And it is his blood that removes those chains of sin that keep us in bondage. So I'd like us to sing the song, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone, and remember Jesus. Would you stand if you're able?
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears removed. I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. Will be forever.